vertical reversal. He was the director of the UN's Health Outreach Program in Eastern Medicine. She speaks about certain breast lesions, glow lesions, and high risk reversal. A practice guide to large media peroxidase.
About a non-surgical complete excision of small non-vulvable breast lesions and suspicious lesions using the large needle biopsy. By large needle biopsy, we mean the breast lesion excision system and the vacuum-assisted biopsy. And these are two automated advanced large needle biopsy devices. Today, there is no clear international guidelines to set the indications for each. We will depend on the only guidelines of the UK and our experience in the two techniques. Vacuum-assisted biopsy is done using a very convenient device developed specifically for breast biopsy. It's a tool to advance large needle biopsy, utilize vacuum, and with assistance of covered rotating cutter to acquire a large amount of tissue, and there are many brands in the market. This is how this diagram shows the anatomy of the needle. It's three cylinders inside each other. The middle one is the cutter, and the most inner one is the collecting chamber, so that you cut the tissue and acquire the tissue, and it is driving automatically to go into a collecting chamber in the needle. And this small clip shows how the technique is being done. For vacuum-assisted biopsy, after complete sterilization and local anesthesia, we introduce the needle below the lesion and we start applying the continuous cutting rotation and suction, cutting rotation and suction, until you can get all the tissue, the evidence of the lesion removed. As you can see here, we have a small hypoechoic lesion. It's a small fibroadenoma, less than 2 cm diameter. And the video is not compressed. This is the actual time to remove the lesion. We start by cutting. And as you notice, it's a single insertion. It is a benefit for the needle or advantage that it's a single insertion, because you introduce the system closed and you come out with the system closed. When you introduce the needle, it starts cutting. Continuous cutting, suction and rotation, and the tissues driven into the most inner cylinder to come out in the collecting chamber at the end of the needle. And after complete process of continuous cutting, suction and rotation, we complete the procedure by closure of the skin by steel strip and compression bandage around just the chest wall of the lady. And it's very important to advise here to take sort of antibiotic, prophylactic antibiotic, and anti-edema measure for 3 days, and that's it. When you remove the needle, the field is very clear. The complication is not much. Maybe you may encounter small hematoma, but it's easy to be managed. Available in order to get to, you can use it for the set of lesion size. And after removal of the lesion, you can introduce a clip mark for marking of the area that was biopsied. The other system is the percutaneous breast lesion excision system. The percutaneous excision system is a different system. It utilizes radio frequency and suction. The radio frequency utilized by the needle is just the minimum radio frequency for cutting and not for tissue destruction. The needle looks like this. It's a long biopsy wand with five fronds comes out from the wand, and these five metallic fronds give radio frequency in the tissue for 8 seconds, enough to cut the tissue, and then you have an area around an area like this removed totally by the needle. This is a percutaneous biopsy system, the BLAS. It utilizes radio frequency suction for complete excision of the lesion. This is the wand, and it ends into five metallic fronds. This metallic front gives radio frequency to allow complete excision of a lesion. Here, the needle is loaded with the biopsy, and it comes out like this as a complete lesion. The technique can be done under stereotactic guidance or under ultrasound guidance, and there are different sizes of the needle. The needle is not by gauge, the size is not by gauge, it's by the centimeter. It is the diameter of the circle or the basket that is created by the frontlet. You have the 12 millimeter, the 10, 12, 15, and 20 millimeter, and in process, coming soon, the 3 centimeter needle. Percutaneous lesion excision is done also under local anesthesia with small scalpel incision, and then you introduce your needle, apply the radio frequency for 8 seconds, and then you can get the tissue removed as one piece. It's very important when you are going to sample microcalcification to have sample radiography for the microcalcification like this. Here is another video. This is a complex cystic lesion, papilloma. You can see the needle is coming, it's different than the vacuum. We introduce the needle at the apex of the lesion, and because when the radio frequency wires come and surround the lesion, it surrounds the lesion like a basket, like this. So you can get the lesion totally. You do not introduce it below the lesion like the vacuum. And the difference between the vacuum and the bladder is that by the vacuum you remove the tissue in piecemeal fashion so that you can you do not have an access to the margin, whether involved or not, in case of positive lesion. But with the blast, you can have a complete margin around the lesion, either involved or free, but you will be able to know about the margin of the lesion. The indications include the therapeutic indications and diagnostic indications. For the therapeutic indication, it's easy to remove image evidence of a benign lesion like papilloma, fibroadenoma, fibroadenolipoma, suction of a complex lesion, complex vegetation, intraductal seroma. It's a no hospitalization technique, can be done under local anesthesia with better targeting, and the patient can resume her activity immediately and with poor side effects and no disfigurement of the breast. Here we'll show you some of cases. Here is an intraductal papilloma seen as filling defect inside in the galactography and as intraductal solid nodule in ultrasound. And here you can see the field free of the papilloma after vacuum, and this is the tissue representing the papilloma after removal by section. Here is another example, another papilloma, but this time removed with a blast. You can see the lesion, we got the lesion as complete rounded nodule. Then when you prefer to use the blast or vacuum, apparently the blast is better because it allows margin evaluation and vacuum gives the tissue in a piecemeal fashion. However, there are indications and there are situations we prefer the vacuum in this situation. For lactating women, blast is contraindication because it will affect the quality of milk. For patients with breast implants, blast is also contraindicated because the heat will affect the integrity of the implant. When patients with electronic devices like pacemaker, it is not suitable to use radio frequency, it will affect the pacemaker. And also when having multiple lesions, this is not an absolute contraindication, but there is a big difference between the two needles. The radio frequency needle expired after cutting one lesion because the radio frequency got expired. So it's one needle for one lesion. However, the vacuum is a cutting process. You can use it for many lesions. So if you are going to remove two fibroadenomas in one session, it's preferred to use the vacuum. But it's not an absolute contraindication. We can use two needles if the patient or if their doctor wants that. Also, the vacuum-assisted biopsy, if you have a lesion close to the skin or close to the pectoralis muscle, you can inject saline or local anesthesia mix it with saline and create a dead space to allow the needle to be introduced under the skin with safety or above the pectoralis measure with safety, above the implant with safety, but when having radio frequency needle, the needle pop out like a basket, so you have to have a space at least 6 millimeters below the skin or 6 millimeters above the pectoralis muscle. So to sum up for the indications, for lesions below 2 centimeter diameter, prefer to use the blast, especially in solitary and having a quiet distance below the skin and below the pectoralis muscle of 6 millimeters. The patient is not lactating, not pacemaker, not implant. And in this situation, you will be able to assess the margin if positive or negative. For vacuum-assisted biopsy, we can use it for lesions more than 2 centimeters. The size is not a contraindication. For multiplicity of the lesions, it's not a contraindication. And lactating or implant or pacemaker is not a contraindication. Here is a multiple fibroadenomas before and after vacuum, can be removed in one session. And here is a small video showing what is this. This is the breast implant, and we have here a small lesion in a patient with positive, strong positive family history. She wanted to remove this fibroadenoma using vacuum. I think whenever you are able to introduce the needle with safety above the implant and you can see the implant and you can see the nodule, you can see what you are doing, it's possible to use the vacuum. You can increase the slit space by injecting saline or saline mixed with anesthesia, and it's very easy to monitor the suction process without affecting the integrity of the implant. It's a very safe procedure, it's no problem. I will show you this video by Mara. Here is how the less needle works. It's the region is like this pole, and here is the radio frequency where it come out and pop out and surround the lesion. Then this radio frequency, this wires give radio frequency, and this radio frequency in 8 seconds is able to cut the lesion at one piece. See? Vacuum assisted biopsy during the class. So in the vacuum assisted biopsy in a patient with breast implant. For the diagnostic indications, it is indicated for removal of suspicious, for biopsy of suspicious lesions, bias for lesions or bilateral 5 lesions when having lesion size below 5 mm diameter, or having mismatching radiology pathology results after fine needle or coronary needle biopsy, for biopsy of mastopathic lesions or for exclusion of high risk lesions like atypical ductal hyperplasia, radial scar, DCIS, and lobular cancer, or lobular breast lesions, for unclassified microcalcification, especially if involving large sector of the breast, and focal architecture distortion and contraindication to anesthesia and operation. So it's indicated mainly for BI-RADS 3 and for BI-RADS 4 lesions when expecting ADH, ALH, papillomatosis, radial scar, and sclerotic adenosis. Here is a small an example of 5 mm mastopathic area after vacuum proved to be DCIS, 3 mm DCIS. And here is another similar lesion, but after vacuum biopsy, it was proved to be sclerotic adenosis. Here is a small mastopathic area, hypoechoic lesion with clustered microcysts at the periphery. When removed with vacuum, it was sclerotic adenosis. When we have very similar lesions, these lesions, the pathology could be very different while very similar in shape. We have also clustered microcysts, so small mastopathic area, but was DCIS after vacuum assisted biopsy. The underestimation is very high in such lesions, so it's better to remove it by total biopsy. Here is a radial scar, and this is an example of unclassified microcalcification. You will be able to have sample radiography, including microcalcification. So when you have positive results or negative results, you are sure about the results, especially when having lesions involving large sector of the breast. This is a cluster of microcalcification removed by the blast, and it was an invasive duct carcinoma removed with safety margin. Recently, they are thinking about why not to, after having invasive duct carcinoma like 4 millimeter or 6 millimeter, removed totally with the blast, and we have a clear margin, free margin. They think about going for local radiotherapy and the sentinel node without resurgery for better margin because it's already margin free. Here is another microcalcification cluster, but the margin was involved in this case. It was a mixed invasive duct carcinoma and DCIS. Here is an area of architectural distortion. You can see the parenchyma retraction at the left breast. And when comparing it to the area in the right breast, you can see the parenchyma retraction. And this lesion was biopsied with the blast, and it was lobular carcinoma in situ. We have a publication about our results, two publications about our results and presentations in the international conferences. Based on our results, we can recommend the breast lesion excision biopsy for biopsy of suspicious lesions, including virus 3 and 4, and when you are going to expect high-risk lesions. And the results are very similar to the previously published by other researchers. And when comparing these to the results of vacuum-assisted biopsy, with the vacuum-assisted biopsy, you have some underestimation rate, like 12%, but with the breast lesion excision biopsy, the underestimation rate was 0%. So it has the advantage of being, could replace wire localization and open excision for breast lesion, for suspicious breast lesion. As regards the recommendations, NHS recommends the image-guided vacuum-assisted biopsy for removal of benign lesion, and they recommend the image-guided excision range frequency for breast lesion, for suspicious breast lesion. And thank you for your attention.
And thank you, dear Nagla, always eminent and courageous in interventional breast procedures. You are really pioneering this field. And I think we will move the questions to the end of the session. And thank you for your nice presentation. And now I'm presenting Professor Dr. Mimi Chalabi. She's an assistant professor of radiology at Ain Shams University. I'm proud to present her. She's very presentable and ambitious, and she will speak about the MRI bilateral lexicon.